Please stand if you're able and join in the call of worship. Come and give thanks to God who is good.
God's mercy endures forever.
Let us proclaim to all the world that God has been with us through thick and thin.
God's mercy endures forever.
When we experience desolate valleys and times of abandonment, know that God never gives up on us.
God's mercy endures forever.
God satisfies the thirsty and fills the hungry with good things. Come, let us worship God.
Thank you.
Now please join me in our unison prayer. Loving God, in all those times when we want to try something new, go in a new direction, or complain about all we have, still your love is constant. You never give up on us. It's not your nature. We are grateful. And in this time of worship, we pray that you will make your spirit felt among us all. Amen. Peace of God be with you.
And also with you.
Leave your pew and say hello to someone. Go ahead. All the kids, come on up. Come on up. Yeah.
In this time of desperation, all you know is doubt and fear. There is only one foundation. We believe. We believe.
We wanted to play that song for you because, for those of you that don't know, we just returned last night about midnight from our National Youth Convention in Orlando, Florida. And I want you all to know that all five chaperones are here. We took 17 children, five chaperones, and one baby, and we all made it there and back safely. Now, we are missing many kids, and one of the reasons is many of them got back last night, jumped in cars, and got over to the Auglaize County Fair. So they are probably going to be quite tired this morning. So just so you know, I know that we need to hurry, but I want you all to know that, now, Amy, I need your Kleenex. Where are you? I want you all to know how just wonderfully amazing that our kids are from St. Paul's. We asked, they did. Did we need patience ever, kids? Yes. There were some snafus, not related to us, but related to the hotel and the NYE organization. And they just, I can't even express my gratitude to the parents of these children and our church family about just how amazing they were on this whole entire trip. Hopefully they found it inspirational. I believe they had some fun. They got to see things that we don't always deal with here in our community. They heard things that they might not always agree with, but as we told them, it's good to be exposed. It's good for you to be informed. It's good for you to learn how to deal with different things in your life. So with that, I will just start asking them some questions. And you all, you younger ones that didn't go, if you have questions for the big kids, please ask them, okay? But if I said to you, Haley, what was your Jerry moment at NYE? What would you say?
My Jerry moment was actually attending NYE for the first time.
Would you go on and explain what a Jerry moment is, Haley?
A Jerry moment is a first time. So for a lot of us, it was first time being on a plane, first time being at NYE, first time being at Disney. Those are all different Jerry moments.
Carly, what would your Jerry moment be?
My Jerry moment was first time to NYE and first time to Disney.
Claire?
Mine is the same as hers, first time to NYE and first time to Disney.
Jacqueline?
Yeah, mine would be the same. Seeing the castle for the first time at Disney was really cool.
Yeah, being at NYE for the first time was...
What would we say Tyler's Jerry moment was? He ended up in the electric parade somehow at the end and could not get out of it. So he went all the way down Main Street through Liberty Town and on into Frontierland before Tyler was able to escape the electric parade. Tell me about who might have been the most inspirational speaker to you, Leah.
What was he, 15? Aiden. That last name. He's a 15-year-old. His name is Aiden. When he was little, he played his harmonica, and he just wanted to do it, and he set his hat down just because he didn't want his hat on, and he accidentally got a bunch of money from people, and he donated it all, and he's been speaking and donating money ever since to charities, like over 300, I think he said, and he does what he loves, which is music, and that was very inspirational to me.
Jenny?
Yeah, I think the same speaker would have been mine, too.
Okay. Anybody have a different speaker? Her name is Trisha Prabhu.
When she was, like, 14, she came up with the Rethink app to help kids before they post something on social media to stop cyberbullying, so they rethink what they post, which is really cool to see.
Yeah, she got sick and tired of seeing teens commit suicide over cyberbullying. So she, just like Emma said, she came up with this app. Haley?
We had this young lady, she was 14. She spoke about trying to remove child arranged marriages in Pakistan and trying to advocate for additional education for women in Pakistan.
Good. Any others? I don't know if the kids who went, and some of them are young adults, but I'm going to call them kids, if they really understood these speakers that were there, how actually world famous they are. Did you guys catch on to that? Several of them said they had spoken at the White House, before Congress, all over the world. There were also several adult speakers as well. They were fabulous, but I think the kids were who provided us with inspiration. Who can tell me what the Bible verse was for the week? Do you remember what?
It was Hebrews 11.
Hebrews 11:1. If I start it, can you pick up on it?
Maybe.
Faith is the confidence that what we believe will actually happen. Say that with me now. Faith is the confidence that what we believe will actually happen. So that was our Bible verse, our mission verse for the week. Does anyone have any questions for us out there or up here? We could go on and on and talk, or I could, but we do want to express our appreciation to all of you who helped us in the four-year fundraising that we did. We did raise well over $20,000 to send 17 kids, 5 adults, and 1 baby to NYE. I had said earlier in a communication that we were done fundraising for the year, but we're not. We got a call from the Summerfest committee, and they asked us to take care of the cans for the whole Summerfest event, and thus we will receive hundreds and hundreds of dollars for recycling those cans. But you all don't have to help us. We'll take care of that. So anything else anybody wants to say? All right. Thank you all. Oh, I have one more thing to say. I want to tell you all who went, and we'll get it in the communicator. But here are the kids that went on the trip to Orlando with us. We had, and if I call your name, just stand up so everybody can kind of see you. Haley Andreoni, Rachel Moeller, Tyler Nuss, Natalie Ginter, Courtney Nuss, Charlie Walter, C.J. Vanderhorst, Allie Vanderhorst, Emma Wibbler, Kaylee Geyer, Jacqueline Leffel, Claire Kaywood, Carly Kaywood, Leah Strand, Abby Tuttle, Jennifer Briggs McGee, and Madison Ginter. And our chaperones, please stand. Kendra Strand. Kendra had the lovely duty of rooming with me, but she needs a special blessing. Amy Keller, Amy Deringer, there she is back there, Reverend Bray, and myself. And Riley, yes, and Riley Deringer back there, so. All right.
Am I on? I am on. Okay.
Woke up this morning, saw a world full of trouble, and I thought, how we ever get so far down, and how's it ever gonna turn around? So I turned my eyes to heaven. I said, God, why don't you do something? Well, I just couldn't stand the thought of people living in poverty and children sold into slavery. The thought disgusted me, so I shook my fist at heaven. I said, God, why don't you do something? He said, I did. I created you. If not us, then who? If not me and you right now? Well, it's time for us to do something. And if not now, then when will we see an end? All this pain. Well, it's not enough to do nothing. It's time for us to do something. Na 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 na. Well, I'm so tired of talking about how we are God's hands and feet, but it's easier to say than to be. We live like angels of apathy who tell ourselves that's all right, 'cause somebody else will do something. Well, I don't know about you, But I'm sick and tired of life with no desire. I don't want a flame, I want a fire. I want to be the one who stands. I want to do something. 'Cause if not us, then who? And if not me and you right now, well, it's time for us to do something. And if not now, then when will we see an end to all this pain? Well, it's not enough to do nothing. It's time for us to do something. We are the salt of the earth. We are a city on a hill. We're never gonna change this town by standing still. No, we won't stand still. No, we won't stand still. No, we can't stand still. Oh, no. Oh, 'cause if not us, then who? If not me and you right now, it's time for us to do something now. And if not now, then when will we see an end to all this pain? Well, it's not enough to do nothing. It's time for us to do something. Na 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 na. Do something. Oh, 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 do something. Do something.
Thank you, Rachel. Appreciate it very much. The word of our Lord is taken from Philippians chapter 4, verses 4 through 6. St. Paul writes to the church at Philippi. And I'm going to read also and include into that verse 7 as well. He says, "May you always be joyful in your union with the Lord. I say again, rejoice. Show a gentle attitude toward everyone. The Lord is coming soon. Don't worry about anything, but in all your prayers, ask God for what you need, always asking him with a thankful heart, and God's peace, which is far beyond human understanding, will keep your hearts and minds safe in union with Christ Jesus, who is our Lord." May God add his blessing to the reading and the hearing of this God's holy word. Something that I want to say to you about the conference that we were at is that there were over 3,000 young people there. And having 3,000 young people and a fantastic contemporary music band, Catawba College sent, they were wonderful, absolutely fantastic. And just everything was just like it should be for young people. And I mean, it would have been that way, I would think, like it should be for me when I was 15, 14, 16. And what I want to say, the message was a very strong and a good message to a very strong and good people. Every one of those kids there are future leaders, not just of the church, but of communities and of our nation. That's the kinds of kids that were there. All of them thinkers, all of them doers, all of them folk who are going to be somebody, all 3,000 plus of them. So it was nice to be in the midst of that energy, you know, and to feel that energy. It was great. Well, I'm going to talk to you about worry. Worry is able to do terrible things to you. Terrible things. In his book entitled When Bad Things Happen to Good People, Rabbi Harold Kushner, who has written a book in his 80s now that I'm reading right now, it's called The Nine Things I've Learned About Life. Well, in his book, When Bad Things Happen to Good People, which was years ago, he tells an amusing story about a worried 11-year-old boy. He writes that the boy, he says, was, quote, given a routine eye examination at school and found to be nearsighted enough to require glasses. No one was terribly surprised at the news. His parents both wear glasses, as does his older sister. But for some reason, the boy was deeply upset at the prospect and would not tell anyone why. Finally, one night, as his mother was putting him to bed, the story came out. A week before the eye examination, the boy and two older friends were looking through a pile of trash that a neighbor had set out for collection, and they found a copy of the magazine Playboy. With a sense that they were doing something naughty, they spent several minutes looking at the pictures of unclothed women. And when a few days later the boy failed the eye test at school and was found to need glasses, he jumped to the conclusion that God had begun the process of punishing him with blindness for looking at those pictures. To worry is to borrow trouble. Worry is a totally negative attitude to take. In fact, as I searched my dictionary and my thesaurus, I found that all the words ever associated with the meaning of the word worry are in many ways negative in their connotations. Those words are harass, annoy, vex, fret, plague, torment, molest, tease, tantalize. To worry certainly cannot be healthy for anyone. With the tension and the stress that's in this modern world, that it keeps imposing upon us, worry has become more pronounced, and its healthier cousin called concern has taken a back seat. It's okay to be concerned, but worry is the negative part of all of that. The psychologist's offices across our land are no longer filled with people who are truly mentally ill. Because of worry, their offices are filled with what has become known as the worried well. W-E-L-L, the worried well. The worried well are those people who are, for all intents and purposes, physically and mentally well, but they're still plagued with worries. Richard Erickson wrote an article saying, and it was called Caring for the Chronically Mental Ill, in which he said, our culture's thinking has been confounded by the overuse of an illness metaphor to describe every sort of psychic discomfort, deviant behavior, and social problem. Thus, criminal behavior, adjustment reactions, and even the need of the worried well are increasingly construed in the popular mind as illnesses needing psychiatric attention. To care is a virtue, but to grind that care into anxiety creates the opportunity for sin in our lives, you see. And that kind of anxiety is not a result of trusting in God, but is instead a result of just trusting in one's own self, which invariably results in an inward suffering and fears and worries. In the Bible is found the same message that many psychologists today are telling the worried well that they see. To relieve their troubled minds, tense nerves, and worn out spirits, a psychologist might say, do not think about things that may not happen. Take life an hour at a time, a day at a time, and do not borrow trouble from the future. Analyze what it is that causes you to worry. Ask yourself if there is anything you can do to remove it, then make the most of your opportunity to improve what cannot be removed. Once in my last church, I was preaching on the subject, but it was from a different text, and I said, you know, 95% of what we worry about never happens. And a psychiatrist who sat in front of me every Sunday came up afterwards and said, Ed, no, it's 99.9%. St. Paul said all of this way in Philippians. He said, rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I say rejoice. Let your gentleness be known to everyone. The Lord is near. Do not worry about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God, and the peace which surpasses all understanding will guard your hearts and your minds in Jesus Christ. And since we're talking about the big names in the Bible, speaking of Jesus, he himself, Matthew records, said this about worry. Jesus said, I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or what you will drink, or about your body, what you will wear. Is not life more than food, and the body more than clothing? Look at the birds of the air. They neither sow nor reap nor gather into barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not of more value than they? And can any of you, by worrying, add a single hour to your span of life? Is worry going to make you live longer? Probably not. Now, if modern psychotherapists are saying, don't worry, if St. Paul is saying, don't worry, if Jesus Christ, most of all, has said, don't worry, then why do any of us spin our wheels stuck in the quagmire of worry? In recent years, I read a report. The article went to say almost two-thirds of Americans say that stress is costing them sleep. Stress is keeping them awake. The article went on to say that the top reason cited is family issues. And I suppose now there are other issues, you know, things that are going on in the world, things that are happening on our streets, different things that we've talked about over and over again in sermons and things like that. We are a worried people. As well off as our culture may appear to us and to the world, we are not well off. Oh, yeah, we've got all the things we need. I got more shoes than I need at home. Even got a pair of cowboy boots. Thank God for the walking shoes I bought for the conference, though. Those black, ugly things I wore, they felt really good. But, you know, we have all the stuff we could possibly want. But we are suffering spirits. We are suffering spirits because we are the worried well, the worried well off. One of the most popular songs in the charts in the 1990s was a little reggae ditty that simply said in a Jamaican accent, don't worry, be happy. You know, remember that one? And now in the last few years, you know, every time my grandchildren get into the car, hey, Papa, put on Happy. And I got it stuck right there, and I can stick it right into the CD player. And my two granddaughters, 9 and 8, are back there in the back seat. The car is hopping. Yeah. What's his name? Pharrell Williams wrote the song. Or, you know, he didn't write it. It's from a play or from a musical. Say it again. Despicable Me. Yeah, I knew it, but I couldn't. Thank you. It's 66-year-old mind is having trouble here. Yeah, from Despicable Me. And you've seen things on television. You've heard it on radio. But St. Paul wrote it, you see. What I'm trying to say to you, these things we hear today and we talk about it today, but St. Paul wrote it. Jesus taught it. St. Paul wrote it 1,933 years ago. He didn't just say simply that we are to be happy, though. Paul said that we are to rejoice. Rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say rejoice. That's a whole lot more than just simply being happy. Then comes the question, but how can we rejoice with the world the way it is, with the nightly news as oppressive as it is, with our concern that our comfortable middle-class lives are daily threatened? How can we rejoice? It is true. It is not easy to live feeling secure in a world like ours is today. But this world has never been secure. It's just our time. It was the same for those who went through the Depression. It was the same for those who went through World War II, those who went through the Korean War. It was the same for those who went through the Civil War. Imagine what it was like in the Civil War, brother killing brother, sister, you know. Think about that. You never can feel secure in this world. The people to whom Jesus spoke and the ones to whom St. Paul spoke and wrote, though, had it worse than you and I. You think, how could they have it worse? They were the ones Jesus taught to pray, give us this day our daily bread. You know how that worked? In those days, guys went downtown and they prayed that somebody would come along and hire them and give them a job for the day. And then they'd go work maybe in the fields or in the vineyards. And then at the end of the day, they got their 50 cents. And the first thing they did was go back into town, buy some bread for the family, and take the bread home, and that was supper. And then the next day, they'd do it all over again. That's how they lived. They didn't know there was a paycheck at the end of the week. They didn't have any agreement with their employer, you know. They didn't have any of these benefits, you know, that many of us have. They had nothing but what the day brought to them. And they all lived, you know, to the ripe old age of 45 or 50 years. Now, the 8 o'clock group here, the 8 o'clock service this morning, I told them as I looked out over the group, if that was true today, it would have been an empty house. There would have been nobody in the 8 o'clock service because we were all over 50. And most of us, many of us, there are a lot of young people here too, I know, but many of us would already be gone. That's how long they lived in those days in Jesus' times, 45 or 50 years. And that was a real accomplishment. You were an old person. And if you lived to be 60, 70, 80 years old, only you know what they thought of those folks, though, was they thought of them as the really wise ones, the ones that they really wanted to listen to and hear. The prophets, people like that. Well, the difficulties that we face today can be overcome, but they are not overcome by hoping someone else will take care of them for us. And that's what our young people heard at the meeting. You can't think that you're going to sit around and let somebody else do the job for you. We cannot abdicate our individual responsibilities over to the politicians who, in their so-called wisdom, think that they know what's best for us. You cannot abdicate your responsibility over to the CEOs of multinational corporations who tell us what to think or what they want us to think and what they want us to think is good for us and put the commercials on so that we believe that. Nor should we believe that military might in the field always clarifies what is right thinking. Some say might is right. No. Might is sometimes necessary. But might is not always right. Such naivete, history clearly shows, can create a recoil effect that severely damages, if not destroys, what were once glorious cultures. And all we got to do is look at the Roman Empire to see that. History will show. And you think it will treat our culture any differently? How naive can you be? We are to work hard and as hard as we can to eliminate the difficulties faced in our world. If we want our children and our grandchildren to have a better world, we must be dogged in our efforts and not complacent. When you become able, as Paul calls us to do, when you become able to rejoice, is when you know that in spite of the fact that there are still problems in the world, you are working to do something about them. You're not being complacent and sitting back and letting somebody else do it. How even small or how even great the work one is doing may appear, that person can rejoice in knowing that she or he is trying to make a difference. For most people, it's easier to give away their power. And that's what you do. We say, let George do it. And I speculate that we got let George do it out of the fact that in the early colonies, George Washington, who was our first president, they really wanted him to be the king. They wanted George to do it. They wanted George to make the decisions. And he said, no, I'm a citizen like the rest of you. I'm just going to settle in and be one of you. But I'll be your president for a while. That way, If things go wrong, you know, if you just let George do it, if things go wrong, then it's the other guy's fault. I had nothing to do with it. But if things go wrong or go right, we are all affected by that. If we give up our power and we let other people make the decisions and let other people decide what our lives are going to be like, we give up our power, then we have no reason to complain. It is important, therefore, for Christian people to not give away their power with which God has entrusted us. We are the body of Christ in the world. We are his hands, we are his feet, we are his voice in the world. If we do, the only outcome, when we give up that power that God has given to each of us, the only outcome is going to be worry. Worry is not really concerned about dealing with the problems and challenges of this world. Worry is not concerned about jumping in there and making a difference. Worry, as I see it, is caused when a person wants to figure out how he or she can avoid being affected by whatever is going on around that one. That's what worry is about. You're worried about something. You're worried about how is it going to affect me. Worry is self-centered anxiety. Grapple with that one. That's mine. Worry is self-centered anxiety. It steals away from you such things as joy and peace and happiness. Worry is nothing more than one's obsession with the pain that in that one's life. When you become obsessed with the pain that you feel and you worry about it all the time, it's what it is. It's worry. It's all about me. Worry will not change the facts of any situation. What they are is what they are. And you know, in the last number of years, the phrase, hey, it is what it is. You hear that all the time. Hey, it is what it is. And what does that mean? You're not going to change it. You're not going to make it any different. But if you worry, worry just robs us of the joy of living. Well, in the scripture it teaches, this is the day that the Lord has made. I will be glad and I will rejoice in it. Why? Because who knows what tomorrow will bring? We don't know that. We need to learn to love the life we have today. Worry and fret over tomorrow will not allow one to do that. You know, if I'm worried about tomorrow, I'd have trouble preaching to you or talking. Yeah, there are things down the line that I'm concerned about, things down the line that, you know, you have to plan, you have to think about what's going to happen here, what's going to happen there, you know, if you have set out a good plan for your life. But sitting and worrying and stewing about it isn't going to change things. Why? Because who knows what tomorrow will bring? We need to learn to love the life that we have today. We worry and fret over tomorrow will not allow one to do that. As you've heard me say before, worry only borrows trouble from tomorrow that may never come. It is enough to live this moment. And actually, this moment is all we actually have when you think about it. Truthfully, this very moment, this very breath of air that you took, this is all that we have really when everything is peeled away. I imagine a physician will tell any of us that most gastric disorders are results of inordinate amounts of worry due to the stress in our lives. How will I face tomorrow? How will I face tomorrow is the killer question. That's the killer question. What then is the remedy? Well, the remedy, I think, is take responsibility for living each day to the fullest and trust in God for your tomorrow. Believe that God will get you there. Trust that God will guide us through the valleys of our lives and shield us from the storms. The remedy is to adopt an attitude that I cannot change yesterday, and I really can't know what tomorrow may bring, but I do have today, and I will make this day a good day. I will rejoice in the Lord, because this is the day that the Lord has given me. To worry is to only do terrible things to yourself. The word itself hangs out with other daily disruptors found in the dictionary. I'll repeat them again. Harass, annoy, vex, fret, plague, torment, molest, tease, tantalize. Those are the words that they go parallel to worry. Bad group to hang out in. Bad group. If those words are considered parallels, their meaning to worry, then worry cannot be good for you. And it cannot be good for me. Accept St. Paul's prescription for your life. Dr. Paul wrote in his prescription, "Rejoice in the Lord always, and again I say rejoice." Will you pray with me? God, help us, because it is difficult to rejoice in the Lord always when we see things going on around us that disturb us. It is difficult when we have difficulty paying our bills or we have difficulty with our health. It is difficult when something's going wrong with one of our children or one of our children has walked away from life with us and caused us pain. It is difficult when we lose a spouse or we lose a job or we lose something that's important to us. It is difficult. It is all difficult. And we tend to worry. But you, God, have said through your prophets and you have said through your apostles and you have said through your son, Jesus, that there is no need to worry because you will walk with us through it all, through it all. And we need to learn to trust in Jesus and learn to trust in you. And so, God, give us the opportunity to learn that in our lives and help us to see the truth behind all of this that the Scripture teaches and how important it is. And may your word live in our hearts like songs we hear on the radio. May your words breathe through our lungs, and may they come across on our voices when we reach out to others and say that God is love and God is our power and God is our strength and God is our Redeemer. Help us to help ourselves. Be with those who can't be with us today. Be with those who are serving our country in far-off lands. Be with those who are ill. Be with those who are in need of some awareness of you in their lives and stay away from you because of fear. Help us not only to help ourselves, but to help others, because we find that in helping others, we really learn more about who we are. Help us to be strong in our faith and to be the people of God we should be. Bless this church. And bless the other churches in this town too. Bless their pastors. Bless their families. Bless their staffs. Be with each one of them. And watch over this world, God, because it's the only world we have. Help us to be better to it and better for it. Oh, Lord, we pray this prayer because we've been taught that there's only one to whom we need to pray when Jesus said that we can pray, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen." One of the gifts that God has given us is the ability to give. Give time, give talent, give treasures to serve the common good, to serve the world, to serve our country, to serve our culture, to serve our church. And so what we do is when we give, we do something that even empowers us more. Because you become more empowered when what you have does not own you and you're able to give it away. That feels really good. Believe me, I know. And so what you give will be a blessing to you. and will be a blessing to God's work, and God will be always grateful to you for it. Give what you can. Thank you for your love for us. Thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ, in our lives. Thank you for this church. And thank you for the ability to share of our wealth, a portion that would make things happen in your name. Bless the hands that brought these gifts to this place. May they continue to prosper. May they continue to be able to give it away. And may they feel the presence of your love in their life all the day long. Be with those who bring also with this their talent and their time to serve you well in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. I wouldn't have held it against any one of the teenagers if they'd have fallen asleep in the church service this morning, because they didn't get a whole lot of sleep, I don't think, throughout the week. But they stayed awake. I'll report. Go out into the world understanding that you are the body of Christ in the world and that your love is the love that the world needs. Go out into the world knowing that Christ died for you and has brought new life into your life. Go out into the world and be the church. Be people who don't worry, because you know tomorrow is in God's hands. And you know God has already won the victory. Go out into the world and be loving, faith-filled Christians. God will bless you. God's face will shine on you, and God will grant you peace.